Good evening, Life Center. Thank you for the privilege of letting us into your living room. I'm really excited for what God's going to do tonight and what God's doing in the earth. And I just say, how about we go to heaven tonight? How about we go right up to where God is and looking down on the earth and what he's doing? You know, I want to start because I don't want to be insensitive, but anybody who is in pain right now, anybody who's suffering, anybody who's in crisis or lack, even if you've experienced sickness or death, I just want to pray for you that God would be a comfort, a present help in time of need right now. And I say that because I'm going to say some things and I don't want to act like I'm not sensitive to other people's pain. It's just that I want to be a voice of hope. And I don't just want to be sensitive to pain. I want to be sensitive to God's goodness and his sovereignty and his glory that is coming into the earth. You know, and there are tragic circumstances, but this is not a tragedy unfolding. This is the goodness of God crashing into the earth in early stages. You know, Jesus is the Alpha and the Omega. He is the beginning and the end, and that's not all. He is everything that's in the middle. It all is him, and it all belongs to him. And all of history is this. It is his story. That's what's unfolding. And I'm not saying God caused coronavirus or he's hurting anybody, but I just want to say this. God uses everything. There's nothing that came into the earth that he didn't use for his purpose. God used Judas, God used Pharaoh, and God will use coronavirus for his purpose. And I believe that the danger is not just the present storm, that there's another danger to not see the God that is 1,000 times bigger than the storm. Living in fear is not living. Our God is a billion times greater than coronavirus, and what he is gonna use it for is he gonna make it better than if coronavirus never came. He reigns on high, and I feel like this invitation from the Spirit to come up higher, that there's a divine perspective that he wants to release into our lives. You know, Elisha's servant, Gehazi, he couldn't see what was actually going on. And Elisha said, God, open his eyes. I feel like the Lord wants to open our eyes to break the spirit of fear. You know, in Hebrew, the same word that is for crisis is the word for birthing stool. See, what the enemy would taunt and breathe on us is that this is for despair and destruction, but God would call it transition. And we don't want to get lost in transition, but we want to lay hold of a narrative that's unfolding before us because there is a storyline that only God could write in the midst of this. There is a divine plot that is unfolding before our very eyes, and what seems like it's actually chaos is actually a divine setup. And so I just want to talk about that a little bit because this narrative is unfolding before our eyes. And so there's some things that are just interesting. One, I want to say the fact that at the height of coronavirus passing over, it just so happened that it was Passover. That's so interesting. And everybody, just like they were a few thousand years ago, they're stuck in their home while something passed over. If I would have told you 2 years ago that this would happen, nobody would believe me. You know, and there's other divine plot lines. It's interesting, we're all stuck at home. Nobody can work. You know, and I think, what is this? I said, Jesus, this is Sabbath. Now, Sabbath was supposed to be every seventh year, you were supposed to take the entire year off and rest at home. Israel had a hard time doing it. In fact, they never did it. And they actually had to go to Babylon for 70 years to make up for all the times they didn't get. But we are in a present Sabbath that's right in front of us. And I believe that this Sabbath has a purpose and that in the Sabbath is a jubilee for us. Now, jubilee was a reset of the boundaries. It was when you got your original inheritance back. So everything that happened, it happened every 50 years, but everything that you lost or you gave away or was stolen from you at Jubilee would all be set back to normal and there'd be a new establishing of boundaries. Now, these plot lines and timelines and storylines are actually unfolding right before us because God is God. God is God of coronavirus. God is God of 2020. And so I wanna highlight a few of these ideas because to find out what is the Spirit saying? Because I don't think they're just coincidences. It's a message from God. Listen to what I'm showing you in this. And so I wanna start by talking about covenant and communion. You know, it was on Passover that Jesus instituted communion. And so I think this is interesting that, you know, I don't watch too much social media, but I received an email that Lou Engel said that there's a communion revival was upon us. And so I wanna understand what is communion and what does it mean for us and what is God saying to us? So I think we need to understand the nature of God, the economy, the values, the way that he thinks and how he governs if we're gonna understand communion. See, our God is a covenant-making God and he is a covenant-keeping God. Now this idea feels so foreign to us because we live more out of situation. But God does not live out of situation. See, I think we have to understand that when Israel was led out of Egypt with signs and wonders and the strong hand of God, totally sovereignly, Egypt couldn't stop them. It wasn't because God just had mercy on Israel. It was because God made a promise 400 years before to a man named Abraham. And it was the covenant that drew them out. You know, when Balaam went to go and curse Israel three times, and he opened his mouth, and cursed and came out, blessing came out. It wasn't because Israel was good that day. It was because God made a covenant hundreds of years before with Abraham that he would bless him. It was the covenant that did the work. You know, when David came up against Goliath, he didn't think, you know what, I can take him. I feel like I can take him, or I'm anointed. You know what he did? He said, who is this uncircumcised Philistine? Because to him, it wasn't about how big he was. It was a matter of covenant. Covenant was his battle. And covenant was his victory. David had the mind of God and the economy of God and the government of God in his head. God is doing something in the midst of this parable that is meant to establish something inside of us. See, I think that we have misunderstood the loyalty and the depth of God's commitment to us. That he would bind his very self to us for eternity. That he would make our story his story and his story our story. That there's nothing else in process. Our soul may be in process, but God's covenant is not. See, I believe that even the reason that Jesus came to the earth and took the sins of the world upon him on the cross was not just because he loved the world. It was because God made a covenant with Abraham saying, in you, I will bless the nations. That it was the covenant that brought him here. Even at the cost of his own life, God keeps his word. And I believe the Holy Spirit is attempting to remove us off the ground of circumstantial peace or emotional connection with God, or even just experiential, and bring us onto the ground of covenant. What if the Goliath of coronavirus came down inside covenant and not inside even just praying in tongues? And I'm not saying we don't fight. I'm saying we fight from the covenant like David did. You know, what if the fate of coronavirus was decided 2,000 years ago and the body of Christ had peace in it? See, all of his promises are yes and amen in him. They're not just yes and amen. God is more than good. He's always been good. But the covenant of God gives us a connection that's far superior to our own capabilities and capacities. See, God's restoring a covenant people, not just the people who love his presence. And I'm not saying that they're separate necessarily. But God is restoring covenant to our hearts and minds and lives in a parabolic living way. You know, and I believe in the midst of all that's happening, that there is a rest for the people of God like they have never known in their life. That there is a sanctuary in your very home for you. And there is a peace that surpasses understanding. And I'm not, you know, I'm in relationship with God, that's true. But there's something greater than my relationship, and it's the covenant that he has with me. And inside of that covenant, I have a relationship. It's more sure than I am. And it is the foundation of my relationship. And God wants to deliver us from living out of our performance and our situation and give us this mindset in which there is total rest. It says in Hebrews 4 that there is yet a rest for the people of God. And I'm telling you, that is right here, right now. And in the midst of everything that is shaking, it's meant to deliver us into something that cannot shake and does not shake. See, I believe in the midst of all of this, that God is doing it for this reason. I'm not saying he's using it for this reason. To reveal Jesus Christ. Shaking exists to reveal that which is unshakable. And this, it looks painful, but this could be the greatest act of mercy. Imagine if you had a house built on sand and you never actually knew it. And then finally you get to discover. This is not substantial. So, sorry if I'm intense. Zeal for the Lord of hosts has consumed me. So our confidence is not in God's mood. Our confidence is in the covenant. And that when we take that cup in our hands and we take communion, we're not just remembering that Jesus paid for our sins. I mean, that's good, but we're entering into the covenant promise of God. We're entering into the surety, irrevocable words that were spoken from his mouth to bring us someplace we could never get on our own. So, sort of in relationship to this, I want to talk about circumcision. See, circumcision was the mark of the Jews to show that they were in covenant with God. It's what David, he said to Goliath, hey, you don't have it. You're not in covenant. And so Abraham, he was circumcised, and so were all of his sons, it was for men only, and all of his servants. And this was the sign that went through the generations. So I believe in the midst of coronavirus, this is what God is doing, circumcision. And you say, well, what do you mean? Should we get knives out? I'm saying, no, it's not that kind of circumcision. See, circumcision was a type and a shadow and a prophecy of a New Testament reality. And so this is what it says in Romans 2:29. It says, a Jew is one inwardly, and circumcision is a matter of the heart by the Spirit, not the letter, and his praise is not from man, but God. And so the mark that you are in covenant with God is the circumcision of your heart. So, you know, we have entered this Sabbath-like circumstance, and you know, for workaholics, it kills them. They don't know how to sit still. But, you know, I believe that there's divine purpose in what's happening. You know, we're limited to our homes, and in doing so, I've found that I've gotten in touch with things that I couldn't get in touch with the velocity of life that we were living at. You know, you can gain the whole world and lose your own soul. And this time, you know, the first day I was like, hooray, we got a day off, that's great. You know, 3 days in, I was like, oh my gosh, what am I gonna do? But as it progressed, I found that there were some unforeseen blessings that happened in the midst of this coronavirus. I found that as life slowed down and I slowed down, I was able to hear things I couldn't hear in the motion of life and see things I couldn't see in the motion of life. And I believe that this is actually God's mercy and kindness. You know, heaven is not saying we're in time out, we're waiting for this to begin again. It's actually working in the midst of what's happening. And as much as we have peace in this time, God wants to give us purpose. If we have peace without purpose, I don't think we have the full kingdom. And so what I found is, you know, lethargy, I believe, is connected to absence of vision. That when you know where you're going and what you're doing and even what this season is for, you can cooperate with it. You know, without vision, people actually perish. And there's something that God wants to release in us that we don't waste the Sabbath, but we actually use it, because this Sabbath, what it's doing inside of us is leading us to Jubilee, which is a resetting of the boundaries of our hearts and minds for a purpose. You know, I think going in to the time that's coming, that there's gonna be a high value on health. So it's not simply spiritual things. It's natural order, it's health. You know, I think God, what if God touched the American dream and shook it for one reason, so he could release heaven's dream into our lives? Prosperity is not what you have when your bank account is full. Prosperity is what you have when your bank account is empty. God is not withholding life from us. And I feel like God wants to give us some Jacob moments where we say, God was in this place and I knew it not. Because if you quiet yourself and you listen, I promise you that what you're gonna hear is Jesus knocking on the door of your heart. That you're not waiting to get back to work. That's not what's on heaven's mind. That this reset isn't for the world. This is for you. This is for me. And that he is knocking at the door of your heart, wanting to bring a depth and intimacy and a restoration and a reset to your lives. And it's actually his mercy and kindness. And maybe the workaholic needs to be slain in this. Maybe it's part of what God is cutting away. Because what I've found is these blessings have come upon me of gratitude and connection. It's the work of the Spirit in my heart. It's not by might, it's not by power. It's God removing things off of my heart. We're not in time out, we're in preparation. See, if you were sleeping, you wouldn't know that you were sleeping until you woke up, and then you could recognize you were sleeping. Now, I'm not saying this in a broad stroke, but I'm saying that God, you know, it's not, people say, well, what is God doing in the nations? What is God doing in the world? What is God doing in the church? You know what? The most important thing is, what is God doing in you? And imagine if there was a reset before you and God wanted to hit the button with you, but you couldn't see it. Jubilee is a time of celebration and restoration. And I believe that's what this is for. You know, It doesn't matter if you've been walking with God for 40 years. Everybody gets a reset. It's not a punishment. It's a kindness. And I know there's difficulties and kids and rain. Trust me, we're going through it. But that doesn't mean there's not purpose in it. It doesn't mean that there's not gold for me to find in the middle of it. Because this is all going somewhere. You know, God's narrative isn't happening in this building. God's narrative is happening in you and in your life. The Sabbath has come upon you. The Passover has passed over you. And I believe that there's actually a divine timing, not just divine narrative, but God is doing something. And if God met us sovereignly in a Passover, will not the Lord meet us sovereignly in a Pentecost? And the preparation is important. The consecration is important. God has hijacked time and space and the world and world history to display Jesus. And I believe that it's a time to set ourselves apart. You know, there were 120 in an upper room on Pentecost. They weren't having a cocktail party. They were waiting with anticipation. And I believe that there is such a brilliant hope in the heart of God that he wants us to connect with, not just wait till this passes, but come into a place where, no, there is an outpouring of the Spirit, and I believe it's like we've never seen. And this preparation is important because Pentecost wasn't just about an outpouring of the Spirit. It was about the harvest. And I believe something is coming upon us that is totally sovereign and totally God, and that we're not being held back. We're being pulled back like an arrow to get launched at a velocity we've never been before in our life. And our house in order is important. And our reset is for us, and it's not against us. And so, I say this, it's not powerful unless it's personal. And I don't know if we'll be able to meet together for Pentecost. But I know they did not get in that upper room by accident. You know, you could have no fear, but if you don't have a brilliant hope, you don't have all that God wants. And I think God wants to do something personal and powerful in our homes, and he wants to make our houses into upper rooms. And I want to encourage you and challenge you in this way. Will you make an upper room in your house? Will you believe in the goodness of God that is so real that you set yourself apart like the 120? By the way, today is the 120th day of the year. I believe heaven is speaking something to us, and that this is the most hopeful time in history. In the darkest dark, a light is gonna rise in us and through us. Don't let the enemy steal your purpose in this time. This is not a time of drought. This is a time to receive oil. This is a time to receive healing and wholeness. There is grace present to set things in order. And so our Bible story is being written. You know, we could call it the Book of Life Center, but how about your book? How about your story? The Book of Life Center is all of our stories combined. Do you have space in your life for a visitation like we've never seen? Do you have the hope that's actually in the gospel? Don't get put to sleep with the circumstance. Many, many prophecies and many prayers are all about to come to pass. And this time is a gift. It's a setup. God has loosed coronavirus as a trap, not for the body of Christ, but for the enemy to take down giants and release his kingdom on the earth. So families of Life Center, I bless you. I pray that a spirit of wisdom revelation would be poured out upon you, that you would so know the time and season, that you would be overflowing with the purpose of God in this time, and that you would be a bride made ready, that you would be prepared for what he's about to do. And God, I ask for a release of dreams and visions, God, of tomorrow, things that make us ponder in our heart and prepare like Noah for something that you promised. Father, in Jesus' name, I bless these precious people. Well, guys, thank you so much. I hope you're encouraged. And we look forward to seeing you guys on Sunday. Have a good night.